You're listening to the audio production of Chasing the Bright Side. Embrace optimism, activate your purpose, and write your own story by Jess Ekstrom, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit thomasnelson.com/p/brightsideaudio.
Introduction. Hey folks, I'm Jess. I'm a rowdy sports fan disguised as a polite Southern girl. I'm obsessed with my dog. My husband's pretty great too. I'm an entrepreneur with no business plan. I laugh at my own jokes. I can't touch my toes. I don't own an iron. I think I'm the only person who can't keep a succulent alive. And I am always on the hunt for my next burrito bowl. But before we dive in, I think it's important for you to know some of my core beliefs. I believe that French fries don't have any calories if they're on someone else's plate. Thrift shopping counts as exercise. If you bring an umbrella, it's not going to rain. Coffee goes towards your daily water intake. Menus with pictures help me make more informed ordering decisions. My dog completely understands when I speak to him in full sentences. Yellow traffic lights mean you floor it. I rate airports by their food courts and seat-to-outlet ratio. Picking up your takeout order on a Friday night still qualifies as going out. Now that we've been acquainted, I want you to know that I am glad you're here. Whether you're curled up in your favorite chair with a cup of coffee, or you're listening to the introductions of three different titles and wondering if this book is worthy of your precious time, here's a quick peek at what this journey will be like. This book will have lots of stories. Good, great, funny, bad, and really bad, of how I created a company that's helped hundreds of thousands of kids with cancer. I've been able to share this mission on shows like The Today Show, Good Morning America, and The View. Celebrities like Lauren Conrad, Kelsey Ballerini, Khloe Kardashian, and Lea Michele have marched behind it. And we've now donated hundreds of thousands of headbands to children with cancer in dozens of different countries. But inside all these stories is one consistent thread. And it's the thread that you'll learn to practice as you listen to this book. Optimism. Why optimism? Because anyone who has ever done something great had to believe in something better than the present. As you listen, you'll see that optimism isn't about getting from A to B. Optimism is the rooted belief that there's something good on the other side. It's about the voice in our heads that gives us the green light to chase our dreams. It's about understanding that we can't control all of our experiences, but we can control what they mean to us and the story they write for us. And I'll give you the tools to help you do just that. The stories we write from our experiences help us decide if we're going to start the business or not, if we're going to attempt the pull-up or not, if we're going to pick up the trash on the street or not, if we're going to ask for the promotion or not, if we're going to book that trip or not, if we're going to live life fulfilled or not. The stories we write in our heads tell us how we're going to respond. Are we good enough? Tall enough? Up for the challenge? Is it the right time? But sometimes the voices in our heads tell us it's not our turn, or they make us believe we're not ready. If we listen in those moments, it's easy to get knocked off track. So what happens when we choose to change the story? Opportunity. That's what happens when we move beyond those negative voices and change the narrative to focus on the possibility that there's good out there. And we can bring it into reality. It opens up a whole other world that we might have thought was beyond reach. Everything we want is within our grasp if we're willing to throw perfection out the door and embrace the messiness of the journey. Isn't it crazy to think that the entire life we want is waiting for us on the other side of our thoughts? One flicker of change inside our heads can catapult us onto the stage we were born to stand on. Now, just to clarify, this book is not a positivity pledge. I'm not going to tell you to put on a happy face and skip down the street high-fiving everyone who walks by. Although, if you want to do that, I'm not stopping you. I'm not going to tell you to just add sprinkles and everything will be okay. I'm certainly not going to tell you, don't worry, be happy. Because I think someone already said that. Optimism is that place where we can see and understand the bad, but still believe there can be good. And most important, optimism fuels the belief that we can be the ones to create the good the world needs. If you peel back the layers of anyone's success, optimism is the first seed that has to be planted for any great movement, change, startup, or revolution to begin. A lot of the time, we think the seed is skill set or expertise, so we just don't go for it. As if anyone who joins the circus was born knowing how to swing from the trapeze or jump through fire. None of us was born knowing how to fly a plane, do our taxes, poach an egg, or start a company. We all had to start somewhere. And that somewhere is optimism. So let's debunk this myth that to be successful, you have to have it all figured out, because that's impossible. In order for us to have a chance at making a dent in the universe, we have to be optimistic enough to see something better and confident enough to just begin. We grow and learn on the way to our goals, not in the static planning. I started Headbands of Hope when I was 19 years old. It was a college dorm room startup and as scrappy as they come. For every headband sold, a headband is donated to a child with cancer. Making that happen has been some of the most rewarding, impactful work I could have imagined. It all started with a summer internship at the Make-A-Wish Foundation, with the belief that there has to be good in the middle of the hard stuff, and maybe I can be the one to create it. Well, that's the cookie cutter, podcast interview, LinkedIn bio, let's meet for coffee and brag about ourselves answer that I always give. But it's only a small part of the story. I wasn't skipping around in a flower crown when an idea popped into my head. Optimism came from feeling like I was being dragged down a river. Then I found a branch I could grab to help me stay afloat. I white-knuckled onto meaning and purpose when I felt like I was out of control and being pulled underwater. Maybe we can see the good more clearly when we need it most. Sometimes optimism can be hard because we have to progressively think about things that haven't even happened yet. We have to let ourselves dream of a better next. But the threat of not being optimistic is stagnancy. We can't move forward to a better tomorrow if we don't believe and visualize what could be. Then we must be confident enough to actively march toward that vision. This book will share moments of my life when I didn't just magically find the bright side. I had to chase it. Whether that was with my business, my family, or even becoming a water aerobics instructor. Yeah, I'm serious. When I didn't just magically find the bright side, I had to chase it. Optimism is the combination of how you think, how you react, and how you connect your life to something greater. Living optimistically will set you up for a wild and meaningful life. But if you're one of those people who needs science and data to believe something is important, then pretend Bill Nye the Science Guy is narrating this next part. The Mayo Clinic reports a number of health benefits associated with optimism, including a reduced risk of death from cardiovascular problems, less depression, and an increased lifespan. Harvard Men's Health Watch says, optimism helps people cope with disease and recover from surgery. Even more impressive is the impact of a positive outlook on overall health and longevity. Research tells us that an optimistic outlook early in life can predict better health and lower rate of death during follow-up periods of 15 to 40 years. The National Center for Biotechnology Information says, optimists are significantly more successful than pessimists in aversive events and when important life goals are impaired. Whew, okay. Are you convinced now? This book will not force you to be happier or make you feel like you're not doing enough. I'm tired of lists that guarantee happiness if I just drink more water and meditate at red lights. I'm not going to judge you or make you feel guilty. What I want is to motivate and inspire you to chase the one life you've been given. I'm here to help you train a muscle in your head to see the good, even when it's hard, and give you the extra push to create your own beautiful reality. This book will show you that you can understand and absorb negativity without being consumed by it. It's time to forge your own way and create the life you want to live. Optimism opens the door to the pastures of possibility that are there for all of us if we just look for them. And trust me, it's there for you. So let's stop with the Sunday scaries and say yes to life's offer to live loud, vibrantly, and purposefully. Life is short, and so is my attention span. Fill up your coffee cup and let's get started. Chapter 1. Maybe she's born with it. She refused to be bored, chiefly because she wasn't boring. Zelda Fitzgerald. In middle school, you could probably detect my braces from outer space. I was the kid who opened her mouth in the chair at the orthodontist and they had to call for backup. Every tooth had a lever or chain attached to the other tooth and they were all in this together. My teeth were all like, "Hang in there, Jess! We've got this! Just don't eat popcorn!" Braces were awkward and painful, but I was so thrilled when my mom told me I was getting them because, number one, I got to pick the band color and I had been working up color schemes for a while. Number two, I was one step closer to a beautiful, straight-toothed smile. I was not naive about my desperate need for braces. Every day I looked in the mirror and could see I needed a dental intervention. Even though I knew braces would be uncomfortable and I might look a little funny for a few years, I honestly didn't care. Braces meant I was working towards something better. Braces meant progress towards a beautiful smile. And I was ready for change. Braces were my optimism. As kids, we're just 4 feet of optimism, walking into everything we do like we're going to win because sometimes we haven't experienced enough to tell us that we might lose. And sometimes, as kids, our optimism is so strong that we skillfully find the good, even in the not-so-great moments. My optimism really lit up when I took on the official role of matchmaker. During recess, I would play basketball with the boys while all the girls hung out on the swing set. Before recess, I'd talk to the girls and see which boys they were interested in so I could go on the basketball court and get the scoop. Claire, can you ask Harrelson if he wants to be partners in the language arts project? Lindsay, I know Timmy asked Rebecca to the dance, but we brushed elbows in social studies, so I feel like he definitely likes me now. Can you find out? It was like taking orders before I went to Taco Bell. Okay, who likes who? Who wants what? You want it hot, medium, or mild? This was my way of creating my place in the social hierarchy. I'd play matchmaker so I had some social role to offer the girls' group. Then I'd skip off to the basketball court and extract the information I needed from the boys. Hey, Timmy, are you emotionally available right now? My favorite part was after recess, when we all lined up to go back into school, because that's when all the girls would run up to me and I could report my findings. You know, make myself useful. I would rattle off today's digs. Jess, Timmy's hamster just died. He's still coping. Kendrick would like to ask Sarah or Rebecca to the dance. Either one is fine, he said. Ryan is looking for someone who can help with his Spanish homework. And for just a brief moment, all eyes were on me. For some reason, I never really made the connection that none of the boys were asking me out. I wasn't girly enough to be in the girl groups or boyish enough to be in the boy groups, so I was the medium in between. I was the matchmaker. I created my own value and purpose. And that was good enough for me. Childlike optimism. When we are kids, we have this innate optimism within ourselves about what could be. We're this blank slate of possibility that has yet to be told there's anything we can't do. You want to go to the moon? Sit under the stars and plan your route. You want to be a dolphin trainer? Here's your whistle. You want to start a restaurant that only serves Jell-O? Buy hundreds of those tiny boxes and get to mixing. Nothing is off limits because we haven't experienced limits yet. We haven't been told what's impossible. We haven't equated our scraped knees to our self-worth. We haven't been told our chances are low. We haven't danced with the thought of failure. As kids, we're purely moving as we are because we haven't been told what to be. And when we're in that headspace, we move. We take risks. We jump and we leap because the consequences of it not working out are not in our vocabulary yet. Imagine what you would do right now if the chance of failure didn't cross your mind. For me in middle school, that meant chasing this other dream of mine. When I got confident enough in my matchmaking abilities, I decided to experiment with another personal passion, writing. More specifically, writing something to be published in Chicken Soup for the Soul. Maybe the goals of most sixth grade girls are going out with a boy, making a sports team, or trying not to make their viola squeak. For me, I was in the friend zone with the boys basically until college, and I couldn't try out for sports teams until seventh grade. So Chicken Soup for the Soul seemed like a natural fit in terms of lifelong dreams. It all started when the popular girls would get copies of the book and sit in a circle during recess and discuss the stories, like a modern-day book.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.